Salam sejahtera, anda bersama saya Reza Zulkarpli dan ini Niaga Awani. Kita mulakan dengan perkembangan luar negara. Saham di pasaran Amerika meningkat dalam dagangan pagi ini susulan laporan vaksin terkini yang dibangunkan Moderna. Menurut laporan Reuters, dalam masa yang sama kes yang meningkat ketika ini dan juga penutupan ekonomi di beberapa negeri di Amerika terus ancam pemulihan. Menurut laporan, Amerika dijangka menerima 60 juta dos awal daripada beberapa pengeluar vaksin. Saham yang mendapat perhatian termasuk saham berkaitan pelancongan dan juga pengembaraan. Pada penutup, indeks Dow Jones naik 470 mata, S&P 500 naik 41 mata dan juga Nasdaq naik 94 mata. Dan seterusnya, Pertubuhan Kesihatan Sedunia menyatakan pengumuman calon vaksin COVID-19 Moderna yang dilaporkan 94.5% berkesan adalah menggalakkan. Bagaimanapun, Agensi Kesihatan Pertubuhan Bangsa Bersatu PBB berkata masih banyak yang perlu dilakukan.
Ketua Saintis WHO Dr. Soumya Swaminathan berkata, tempoh menunggu masih diperlukan untuk melihat keberkesanan akhir dan profil keselamatan vaksin tersebut. Ini selepas data diperoleh daripada peserta dalam ujian percubaan vaksin selama sekurang-kurangnya 2 bulan.
We know that in the interim analysis, it appears that the vaccine is actually has a protective efficacy of over 90%. It's about 94%. Of course, we need to wait and see what the final efficacy and the safety profile of this vaccine will be when the whole data is analyzed after they reach their primary endpoint and also have enough follow-up of at least 2 months of half the trial participants for the side effects.
Dalam pada itu, Swaminathan berkata WHO dan rakan kongsi dalam inisiatif COVAX kini sedang berunding dengan beberapa pembuat vaksin untuk diberikan kepada negara-negara miskin. Jelasnya, hasil daripada calon vaksin Moderna dan Pfizer sangat berpotensi, namun menyatakan agensi kesihatan PBB itu masih memerlukan lebih banyak perincian untuk menentukan kedua-dua vaksin itu boleh diedarkan secara meluas. Tambahnya lagi, terdapat juga keputusan ujian akhir daripada beberapa syarikat lain dalam minggu mendatang. Masih terdapat banyak persoalan mengenai perlindungan vaksin, kesan terhadap penyakit kronik dan kesan kepada subpopulasi terutama orang tua. Sementara itu, Ketua Pengarah WHO Dr. Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus berkata kemajuan itu memberangsangkan, tetapi beliau menekankan bahawa organisasi itu terus prihatin dengan kebangkitan semula kes baru yang dilihat di Eropah dan Amerika.
While we continue to receive encouraging news about COVID-19 vaccines and remain cautiously optimistic about the potential for new tools to start to arrive in the coming months, right now we're extremely concerned by the surge in cases we're seeing in some countries, particularly in Europe and the Americas. Health workers and health systems are being pushed to the breaking point.
Is your hand, use the raise your hand function in order to get in the queue to ask.
Dan tentunya sektor perniagaan yang masih terjejas akibat penutupan ekonomi dan juga sekatan penularan COVID-19 seperti pelancongan dan juga penerbangan akan menyambut baik berita ini. Dan juga untuk melihat kepada perkembangan pasaran Asia dan juga Amerika minggu ini, kita bersama dengan Ketua Pakar Strategi Pasaran Global XC, Stephen Innes. Stephen, more good news regarding vaccine trials are emerging. How will this affect trading in the States and in Asia this week?
It's been incredible. We've seen quite a reflationary bounce post the election, and this is just completely attributable to the vaccine boost. Look, we had the Pfizer come out, and that was a 90% efficiency. However, there's some concerns about the logistics, about transportation, given it needs to be refrigerated at very low levels. The Moderna vaccine doesn't have those concerns. This appeals more to Southeast Asia because we don't have to be stored at subarctic temperatures. They can be stored in the refrigerator. This is very, very favorable for regional concerns. So on both concerns, I think U.S. markets continue to revel in the afterglow of the vaccines while Asia continues to revel. I think Asia would get bigger support here because of the recent initiatives we saw with the free trade deals and also the fact that China's economy is basically V-shaped recovery. And this is very good for Asia markets in general because, as we all know, all roads lead through Beijing when it comes to Asia risk. So quite a favorable week, or at least the start of the week. We still don't know what's up the market sleeves as we move through. So fingers crossed we're going to maintain this momentum through the rest of the week.
And would this reverse the gains experienced by stay-at-home stocks?
Interesting. You know, the good thing here is what we really also need is not just a bounce from the vaccine, but we also need Federal Reserve Board support. And the Feds have been unambiguous of late, especially the two top chiefs. If we consider Jay Powell's comments last week, who suggested that he needs a lot of policy support to bridge the gap to when the vaccine is available. And also Fed Clarida last night, who hinted that the Feds are going to enter more quantitative easing come December. This is just absolutely great and completely bridges the gap until the vaccines are ready. This is what the market needs. So my view here is that the, you know, these low rates, for as far as the eye can see, coupled with the growth impact from these multitude of vaccines that are in the pipeline, I think we're going to march away to 4,000 in the SPX, the S&P 500 next year. I think Asia risk is going to flourish, not only because of the U.S. markets, because of the too big to miss narrative and a lot of the Asia tech stocks. So getting back to the question again, as far as tech stocks go, I think tech stocks continue to revel on the lower for interest rates. And Asia, the tech stocks continue to revel on the too big to miss narrative. So positive on both sides of the equation.
But what about reopening related stocks like airlines, hotel and travels? Are they experiencing a resurgence following the news of these various vaccine trials?
Yeah, it'd be very difficult to tell exactly what's going on, whether it's just massive waves of short covering or whether it's investors coming back into those depressed areas. I think a combination of both, and the truth probably lies in the middle. So we're seeing a short covering rally compounded by new entrants coming into the space, especially retail. Retail is very, very shows a lot of bravado when it comes to buying stocks these days, more so than the institutional side, which continues to be a little bit reticent to jump in the markets. But retail through these apps, these low-fee apps that are in the markets right now are just reveling in the markets. And even in the indices, our volumes are just surging as investors' appetite for all things equities is just surging.
And, Stephen, the U.S. is still struggling with this presidential transition. How would this probably affect market sentiment? We still haven't seen a fiscal stimulus package being announced. How is this affecting the market sentiment moving forward?
Yeah, it's sort of being papered over because of the vaccine news. I mean, we've moved from a blue wave to a vaccine wave, and that's basically what's happened. Once we get a little bit of stimulus to throw in the markets. But look, I think the stimulus is more effective when people are reopening. So once the vaccine comes, I think the stimulus would be probably better deferred than actually throwing it at the market right now when people are still in some semblance of lockdowns. Maybe not forced lockdowns, but, you know, in the back of their mind, people aren't that eager to go out these days in the big U.S. markets, especially in the big city markets. They're very, very cautious about catching the COVID, especially with the headlines. The headlines are scary, and we're starting to see states like California roll back the reopening narrative. This is just very, very fearful. Even with the vaccine in the loop, there is a double-edged sword here. People may feel a little bit overconfident, saying, well, look, we got the vaccine coming, so let's just start going outside. People have to be on the defensive. This thing is very, very contagious still, and it's very, very important to maintain those social distancing rules until the vaccine comes.
And let's look at some of the announcements in the U.S. today and this week. The retail sales for October is slated to be announced today. Industrial production for October also today, and Fed President's conference on the economy. What can we expect later today and maybe moving forward this week?
You know, it's interesting. Industrial production is just simply a function of the amount of policy that's getting thrown at the markets. And I think that'll continue to flourish. You might see a little bit of a downtick here because of the elevated COVID levels that are playing out through the purchasing managers indexes. However, when it comes to retail sales, a boss of mine many, many years ago told me never underestimate the purchasing power of the U.S. consumer. Mm-hmm. I think this is going to be great. I think people are spending oodles of money and oodles of time on internet transactions these days. Whether they're not, even if they're not going out to the shopping stores, there's tons of evidence out there that they're spending all sorts of money on Amazon and all these other, e-stores. So I expect retail sales to continue to flourish when you factor in the e-commerce side of the equation.
Especially going to the Christmas and this festive season in December?
You know what? I think even more so. I think people want to lavish themselves with a big online splurge just to put this COVID in the background. Look, they're not going to be able to have big family gatherings. That's probably written off. Certainly Thanksgiving is written off, and probably a good chunk of Christmas celebrations or holiday celebrations, I should say, are going to be written off. But still, I think people are going to lavish their kids and lavish their families because it's been such a depressing year. But you know what? We've got something to look forward to. There's light at the end of the tunnel, and not a glimmer of light. There's all sorts of flashing green lights at the end of the tunnel right now because of these vaccines. And I think people are going to have a really optimistic view transitioning into the new year.
And how will markets in Asia, especially Southeast Asia, respond to this, especially the announcement by Japan yesterday that its GDP expanded or the economy expanded 21%? Will this euphoria be short-lived?
I always warn people just to ignore the GDP numbers because they're coming from such dismal places to like 20-30%. Just doesn't make any sense in a year-to-year basis. I think the key takeaway here is that the economy is recovering, and this is positive. It's coming out of this downturn. But we look at economies, export economies like Japan, Korea, et cetera. A lot of the export nations in Asia are going to flourish once the vaccine gets delivered because those supply chains that have been clogged up because of the COVID are going to reopen again. They're going to be able to send export products over to Europe and over to U.S. The reason being is because there's going to be demand for Chinese, there's going to be demand for Asia, and there's going to be demand for all sorts of products coming out of the Far East once that vaccine becomes available.
Speaking of demand, I think that you've mentioned that Malaysia, as a member of RCEP, would probably help with the boosting of ringgit. Tell us more about this. What about ASEAN and other currencies? Are they also experiencing this boost following the signing of the RCEP?
I would have been happier if India was involved in it, obviously. I think that would have been a bigger bounce. I think that's one of the major drawbacks in it, and also the fact that agricultural products, to a degree, have not been exempt. Another drawback because we know that Malaysia is a good exporter of agricultural products also. However, I think it continues to resonate well. I think Malaysia and China combination exports here is going to continue to flourish. I mean, that's just a really good thing. And I think the fact that there's going to be broader opportunities within the joint countries here, I think this is going to play out favorably over the long term. It's not going to be an immediate bounce because things aren't immediately going to activate, but this is a plan for 2021 and 2022 and beyond. Look, it's taken a decade plus to negotiate this thing, so it's good to see that it's finally over the finishing line.
And how soon will probably a member country see the effect of this RCEP to its financial markets or the real economy out there?
It's going to, it'll start factoring in immediately, but it won't show up in the data for a while because it takes a bit to, for inventories to declog, for supply chains to accelerate more. And obviously the logistics of trading more products within each other also takes a little bit to iron out. But I think this thing will be really good, and I think it'll start to show up quite convincingly in the regional data early in Q1 2021.
Thank you very much, Stephen Innes. Jadi Stephen Innes membincangkan berkenaan dengan prestasi pasaran, jangkaan pasaran. Stephen Innes adalah Ketua Pakar Strategi Pasaran Global XC yang langsung dengan kita daripada Bangkok. Kita akan berehat seketika kembali selepas ini.